Short introduction to our guest, because I have a feeling that you all know him very well and know his work extremely well, and this is Scott McCloud. Why don't you join me first in welcoming him here to SPX. I'm a comics academic, and if you go to comics academic conferences and you hurl a stone, you will hit someone who said, I got started in this field because of understanding comics. But in addition to that, he is reinventing comics and making comics as extended as theoretical apparatus. And of course, we're here to celebrate the release of Scott's massive new and not uncontroversial graphic novel, The Sculptor.
No, not at all.
But I wanted to begin with some questions about theory before we lead into a close reading of The Sculptor. One of the questions that I sent Scott in preparation for this interview was about his theories about comics tribes, which he put to paper in 2006, Making Comics, but which you originally talked about here at SPX around the time that Making Comics was released, right?
Yeah, I had this what I call my toxic theory that we find ourselves sort of like coalescing into these four, what I call four tribes. And I do remember when I came back to SPX in 2006 that we had a lively discussion about this. It was kind of crazy. So yeah, it's kind of fun to revisit it because, of course, these things are always shifting. If you want the slightly less toxic version of it, it may be better to think of them as campfires that artists gather around, because the truth is you can't really categorize an artist. Artists wander, artists change. You know, artists have lots of different interests, but there are a few like really consistent values that you find cropping up again and again in art. And I gave them names. This is like up there, the classicist, animist, formalist, and iconoclast. And basically, the classicists, that particular campfire, that's about beauty and craft and, like, you know, working really hard and practicing and getting everything right. And this idea that, like, okay, perfection may not be available in this life, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't strive, shouldn't go in that direction. And that's got a rich tradition in comics, obviously. Then there's the animists, which is the pure storytellers, the ones who, like, I remember Jeff Smith, who I sort of falls into this category. Right. I remember him talking about how he would just, like, wake up in the morning and ask his characters what they wanted to do today.
Right.
You know, you're trying to bring them to life.
And another quintessential example of an animist would be Barks.
Yeah, very much so, yeah. That idea that I'm here to tell the story, it's all about the audience, right? You know them. They're like 80% of the actual industry runs on those guys. They're like our rocket fuel. And then the formalists, which is sort of where I was for a really long time, the mad scientists, the research and development wing, the people who are like really drawn to figuring out how the form works. Right. Trying out experiments, the sort who, like, you know, if they come up with something that completely and utterly fails, it's just like, well, okay, I learned that. That's a data point.
Can I ask you a question about the formalist, though? You said that for a while you were in that camp, but do you see yourself moving out of that camp with the sculptor?
Well, no, I mean, at heart, I am. But yeah, we'll actually get to that. because that's an interesting diagonal move that I made. And then the iconoclast, which, you know, that particular value of, like, you know, honesty trumps everything. It's okay if it's rough. It's okay if it's messy. It's okay if it, like, looks like a 5-year-old drew it. If it makes you laugh, if it's true, if it's honest, if it just, like, has some real authentic humanity to it, then, you know, like, fuck everything else. That's all that really matters. Right. And that's where, you know, the underground impulse comes from, and that's still very active today.
Although it's interesting that between the formalist and iconoclast, you have this kind of tension between Spiegelman and Crumb.
Well, now Spiegelman has the tension, you know, like Crumb's settled in the lower time ago, and he's distrustful of, like, you know, like, of, you know, people sitting around talking about art and everything, and he's distrustful of the sellouts, who, you know, like, but he's also distrustful of himself, which is why he's so much fun.
Yeah.
That, like, you know, from the very beginning, you go back to 1968, he was already doing comics about how fucked up the counterculture was, and it's all just a bunch of pretentious kids who don't know anything. So he's like the ultimate iconoclast is the person who's even, like, distrustful of iconoclasts.
Right.
And so, you know, he sits there and he draws these beautiful pictures of the tree next to his house.
And then he also minimizes his own contribution by saying it's only lines on paper.
Exactly.
As if they can't change the world.
Right. Humility is, like, a really important part of that lower right hand campfire. Yeah, absolutely.
Now, one of the things I asked you to do, and you were reluctant to do it, and you can maybe explain why.
It's dangerous.
Yeah, that's right. Is that since this SPX is devoted to 21st century cartoonists, people who started cartooning after the year 2000, I asked Scott for examples of folks in that generation who might fall into these camps, and you were like, yeah. No way.
No. Well, no, I couldn't. No, I can name a few names.
Oh, I know
but
you could,
yeah,
but you were reluctant to do so.
Well, it's just. Well, the thing is, okay. Now, here's the problem with it. Here's why I call it my toxic theory. Right? Is like when I talk about campfires, it's like, oh, here's a value. I get it. People like that. But sooner or later, it always turns into McCloud says there are four types of artists. You know, do you know what McCloud? I was in the McCloud panel. You know what he said about you? He said you're this kind.
That's right.
It's like, well, fuck McCloud. I'm not that kind. I'm not any kind. Fuck him.
You might think you're an animist, but you're wrong.
Yeah, right. Of course, that means they were probably in the lower right. But but
especially if they're using the word fuck.
Yeah. Oh no, everybody uses the word fuck. But yeah, I mean, like a couple of really interesting things happen. We're seeing movement, like on all, like in terms of trends. Mm-hmm. I promise I'll name names, but just in terms of
no,
general.
You don't have to.
Yeah, I really will. I really
I don't
will.
Want you
I promise.
In trouble.
No, I won't get in too much trouble. I'll get in trouble no matter what. So it doesn't matter. But yeah, I mean, like there's been some really interesting movements. I mean, one of the things that happened, you know, when we're talking the turn of the century, what's going on in the turn of the century?
Right.
Well, one of the things that's happening, of course, is the web, and we have a lot of like pure formalist things going on. People
yes.
who are just basically like my old pal Daniel Merlin Goodbury in England. People whose whole soul is just like it is time to experiment. Let's play around. Yeah. Meanwhile, you have like the what I think of sort of as the children of Panter, you know, and
yeah.
Spiegelman and Fort Thunder are still burning hot and are really exploring that bottom half of the chart where experimentation and rawness mm-hmm. and honesty
and emphasis
come
on
together.
The picture plane, particularly. In
yeah,
the
exactly.
Yeah.
Bringing it back to the picture plane, but also not apologizing for comics' no. dark underbelly of culture quality
right.
too, which is like that's a really important combo where you know it's got to have some vitality. It's got to have some energy. It's got to have some like low art burn to it,
yes,
you know,
right.
in order to really feel
yeah,
honest.
The smudges of a Chippendale page and the
yeah,
difficulty
exactly.
of reading a Chippendale page.
Right, yeah,
yeah
like
absolutely.
things that like truth to material has
yes.
both a it's on the bottom of the chart, right? Because
mm-hmm.
it's oh, and I should say, oh, this is really important. like these all it's like a total like hideous Myers-Briggs type of a thing, or like Jung's four subdivisions of human thinking, because there are all these dichotomies, right? So you've got, if you look at this thing, you know, you've got the bottom half is all about revolution, basically, except it's a revolution in art. If it's formalism and it's a revolution in life,
in content,
basically,
right.
it's yeah,
yeah.
If it's the iconoclast, and the top is all about tradition, a tradition of art in terms of the classicists, and a tradition of storytelling of and the audience speaking to the audience.
Well, and
in
they
the
also work
the
on
animals.
A vertical axis because
yes.
one emphasizes form and one emphasizes content.
Exactly.
Did I steal your
story?
No.
Well, actually, form and content is a diagonal. We'll get to that, but but then there's it's life versus art on the left and right, and yeah, on the diagonals where it really gets crazy. You have between the classicists and the iconoclasts, it's the old truth versus beauty
yeah.
is going on, and between the formalists and the animists, it's form and content. And when it's really fun is when an artist is playing on the diagonal, this bopping back and forth on the diagonal. I think Jim Woodring, for example.
Or Crumb, who he draws beautifully.
Well, that's what I was saying, yeah.
Beautifully. Yeah.
Exactly. And, of course, the best ones defy all categorizations and, like, you know, make me out to be a charlatan. Because, like, because Chris Ware,
right.
Like, for instance, where do you put Chris Ware? You can't say he doesn't belong in any of these.
Right.
Well,
see,
maybe
that's
animist,
one of the other points that you
animist.
Make, that it's sometimes difficult to categorize an artist in one particular category,
right.
but you can usually easily exclude one that they don't fit into. That's another
yeah,
thing that you
that's
say.
The thing. That's the thing. Even for people who are, like, spread out all over the map, there's
right.
usually one where they don't really grok it. They don't
right.
get it, or they
right.
don't see any
So for where, that would be classicism?
So for Ware, actually, maybe animist,
because okay.
Ware actually has a really tremendous classicist. So I mean, what Ware's doing is like really beautiful, classically
right.
beautiful. That stuff is gorgeous. You can
the
hang
design
it.
Of the page, certainly.
The design of the page and the craft that goes into it, and he's a real craftsman.
Yeah,
he's an amazing craftsman.
Yeah.
But like I say, he's all over the map. You've got revolution on the bottom and tradition on the top and art and life and form and content and truth and beauty and all that stuff. But, okay, so what's going on right now? Right now we have a couple of different currents because we have like the all ages movement is bringing back the tradition of storytelling. People like Raina Telgemeier are just like blowing up in the upper right.
That's right.
And what happens when you have really strong animists like Barks, like Kirby, is you start breeding baby readers and like people fall in love with the form because they're falling in love with the stories in the form.
Right.
And now you have a whole generation and you know, people like Raina are, they are training an army of readers who are going to grow up and start moving
making
into
their own work,
making their own work. Stuff, reading more, you know, progressively more sophisticated or challenging things. Some of them will, you know, they'll spread out in all the different courses. And then things like the Flight Anthology, which I think, you know, preface that movement in the beginning of the century. Yeah.
Okay. Well, you said there were a couple movements beyond the all ages movement. What else do you see?
The graphic novels movement is very much about pure storytelling, but really on the right side of the chart because I think the best of the graphic novel movement is very much about you know, a play for, you know, what you might think of as just plain old literature. Yeah. You know, that's just like people like Alison Bechdel. They're just trying to tell a story in a way, but they're also very much trying to tell a true story, honest story, something that's a little raw, that has some real sociopolitical context.
I want to follow up on that because I think Bechdel, I mean, obviously there's a lot of things going on in Bechdel, and one of those things is this kind of like naked approach to her relationship with her father and her relationship with her family. Yeah. But the other thing that I notice in Bechdel is this kind of emphasis on long-form organization through motifs. Like, if you read Fun Home, you know, we begin, you know, with the exaltation of Daedalus, and we end with the exaltation of Daedalus at the end of the book, like, it bookends. And there are a number of different threads that go through it, Joyce, for example, or other mentions of other literature.
Which
other
is a bit
images.
Of a formalist trick, too.
Right, so yeah, absolutely.
A lot of the best ones spread out on three, really.
Right. So, but I mean, so she's kind of crossing the formalist iconoclast kind of divide, or
because my stupid categories don't hold up
to
anyone who's really gonna you know, like, really engage with
the
medium.
I'm like, yeah, there we go. We'll break down that wall, no matter how much you try to keep it up.
Toxic
right?
theory, but you know, like, I'm trying to put people in boxes, and guess what? That's what formalists do, right? You know, that's what the guy in the lower left does, and you need to, you know, like, you know, occasionally rebel against that.
Well, let's get back to your own sort of diagonal dancing around the various boxes, because it seemed to me, and this is another question that I sent you over email, it seems to me that what your theories tend to focus on are transitions between panels or sort of micro-organizations in comics. So, for example, transitions between panels, expressionist lines inside of panels, figure movement and figure design inside of panels, things like that. Yeah. But it seemed to me while I was reading The Sculptor that you took a great deal of care to have sort of long-term motifs that would repeat and then pay off at the end of the book. Now, obviously, I don't want to talk too much about the spoilers at the end of the book, but was that a conscious attempt to think in terms of those sort of macro narrative structures as well as the microstructures, or
it was. I mean, like, well, I just kept finding them. The thing is, if you're going to do a 500-page book, you're spending a long time with it, and things are just going to like pop up, and you just go, "Oh, look at that!"
Can you give us an example of one of those things that just sort of like landed in your lap and you didn't premeditate, but it was like,
well, like the crowd rings. I have this repeating motif of crowd rings. There's a street theater piece where my protagonist gets, you know, this literally
an angel.
Yeah, kissed by an angel. That sounds bad. But, you know, like the street theater with this room, like, just basically literally comes down and kisses. But before that, he's in this crowd. He can't get through this crowd in New York City, and suddenly all of them are looking at him, and they walk back in this circle, and they actually bow down to him, completely freaking him out. Out of
like
nowhere,
a flash mob.
The whole thing is a hoax. But the thing is that crowd rings. We see it again and again. That idea of the crowd ring. Like, for instance, when he's freaking out and homeless and messed up, he smashes his phone because his service has been turned off. He smashes on the sidewalk, and you see for just a moment, you see the crowd around him. Pulls out, you know, like just like a drop of soap in dirty water. You know how if you've ever seen the way that the dirt like retreats in this perfect circle, you can just see the circle.
Right.
And the circle motif comes again and again. But a lot of them are just rhyme couplets. So like the motifs you're talking about, a lot of them are like every scene in the book has a pair with another scene.
Right.
Now, that's the formalist finding things after the fact. Mm-hmm. But in like the day-to-day storytelling, I was trying to just bury that stuff. I didn't want any of that stuff.
You felt
stuff
like
to
that
be
was
on the
interfering
surface.
With your creative process.
Yeah, there was. Or? Well, it wasn't interfering with the process, but if the reader sees it on first read, that doesn't work.
Right.
Because this, and this goes back to the tribes again, even though I live in the lower left-hand corner there, even though I'm like one of the tinkerers,
and
the ultimate goal for a formalist, or the kind of the prize, the brass ring, is to impersonate your opposite number. And that's what I was trying to do with this one, is I wanted to create something that read...
Wait, let's unpack that a little bit.
Yeah,
that
no,
sounds like a very enigmatic phrase. You mean... impersonate your opposite number in the sense
the opposite end of the tribe.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you meant like opposite person or something.
No.
Okay.
Is to become an animus.
Right.
Spiegelman, who's like the for a long time, Spiegelman was the ultimate comic formalist.
Right, in breakdowns and that.
Yeah,
material.
Especially breakdowns. So early Spiegelman, right? And when he was co-editing Raw with Francois Mouly.
Right.
But and even though there was a part of him that was always ashamed he wasn't more of an iconoclast, you know, when you see
that's
that too, you see that tension. But the thing is still, he was in the formalist box. But what's great is that when he did Mouse, he tried to be the exact opposite, because that's the ultimate formalist experiment, is to leave behind everything and pretend to be the other thing. Because that's a really interesting formalist challenge, is to stop being a formalist. It's very, I don't know, it's some kind of enigmatic
thing.
So
Mouse is his attempt.
Mouse is that.
Right.
And but only the first volume, because then he got all meta.
But
my editor at the time when I was doing this old series, Zot, years and years ago, I mean, we're talking decades ago, she was visiting, thank you. She was visiting Spiegelman in his apartment, and he had this panel where it said, it's like Vladek, his father is talking about going, you know, taking a train.
Sure.
And the caption was in the shape of a railway ticket. And she said, I like this caption in the shape of a railway ticket. And
he took it out then.
Yeah,
right?
No, that's exactly it. Spiegelman said, I'll take it out. And she said, no, I said, I like it. And he said, yes, but you stopped reading. And this is just so ironic, because Spiegelman wanted you to stop reading every 10 seconds throughout all that breakdown stuff.
Yes.
But that wasn't the purpose of this particular project.
Right. Every panel in breakdowns sort of demanded that you... Now, there's three pictures embedded inside this panel and try to figure it out. Yeah.
Breakdowns was basically slow down and think.
So is that what you were trying to do in the Sculptor? You were trying to be a formalist, but in a way that
was saying speed up and stop thinking.
Yeah. That's
a lot of people. A lot of people read the Sculptor in one sitting. It's 500 pages.
Right.
But that's what I was shooting for, because I wanted it to just have this... what happens next kind of a flow to it. And that's one of the reasons I laid it out 40 pages at a time in Photoshop, so that it would just have, it would compel you to keep going.
That's interesting. For a model for that, were you looking at something like Craig Thompson's work, which is usually sort of gobbled up in one big sitting?
No, I just like the way Craig draws people.
What's not to like?
Yeah, what's not like? Right, yeah, right. No, he's really good. No, I would, if I could go even like a third of the way towards the fluidity of somebody like Thompson, I've always been very wooden and stiff in my art, and that was another thing, was I wanted to see if, can I at least, and I actually got human models to help me,
because
my figure drawing sucks, it's always sucked, but at least maybe if I could come up with something that had some life to it, that breathed, that maybe it would compel people to keep reading and be interested in the characters.
That's interesting. You're kind of hard on yourself about the life drawing. Is that...
Oh, no. I have lots of backup on that. That's not just... No. Many people will confirm that.
But in some ways, the artistic struggle...
better.
In some ways, the artistic struggle that you were doing with the book was sort of the artistic struggle that the book is about.
Yeah, to some extent. Any fiction is, has some autobiographical elements.
Right. Or it can serve as a metaphor for the creator's plight or
something. Yeah, absolutely.
Like that,
right? Yeah, okay. Yeah. No question about it.
Several of you applauded when we were talking about Zot. So what I wanted to do very briefly is to make some connections between some of Scott's earlier series and books and the Sculptor. For example, my friend Sean Kleefeld said, he sent me this and I thought it was wonderful. He said that in some ways Destroy is like the other of the Sculptor, in that Destroy is all, I'm quoting Sean here, was all about mindless wanton destruction, but the Sculptor is all about thoughtful, considered creation. And matter of fact, to the point where you have to shut off that part of yourself and just do it rather than sort of sit around and talk about doing it.
Yeah, it's true. Also, a lot of my stories seem to be about messing up New York for some reason. I don't know what that's
about.
It's
a D.C. experience. You had the experience in D.C. and you want to level New York after
yeah,
that.
No,
right?
I think so. Yeah, I lived in New York when I was thinking right? about it. Yeah, all of the villains in Zot actually were paired with a New York skyscraper.
Well,
I had a character called Zybox that was perched on top of the Trade Tower.
That's true. That's true.
The character of Bellows attacks Zot at the top of the Empire State Building.
That's true.
And Nine Jack Nine. I said this for the three people in the audience who know what I'm talking about.
I'm there.
With the straw skimmer at an angle and the pinstripes, he was the City Court building.
That's true.
The Chrysler building, of course, is one of the villains. How could I leave that out? A character called Deco, whose head is the Chrysler building. And what was interesting is I picked the World Trade Center for Zybox because, to me, it had no personality and was bland and had no story. And he was this sort of bland, soulless creature. And, of course, it got its story later.
It sure did. The other book that I see a connection to is, again, Zot and the Sculptor. In particular, the scenes with David and Meg sort of talking about David being a virgin seems to me to be a kind of rewrite and a kind of extension of Zot 35, where Zot and Jenny talk about having sex for the first time. Do you think that's accurate, or do you think that's...
A little. Well, I mean, you know, I like just people who talk about sex frankly I like sex positive stuff. Anyone see Magic Mike 2?
No.
It's a very weird movie, but it's almost like fan fiction or something. But like, it's just, this is what sex positive looks like. It's like maybe some sex will improve this person's life here.
Maybe this person
wonderful?
Just needs to get laid, which is kind of what he
right. Yeah, it's like, yeah, right, exactly. He just needs to get laid.
That's right.
I like simple explanations.
I mean, doesn't Meg say it's something like it's you know, I have a muscle problem or something? Or, no, it's not that.
Don't even try to summarize it. It's, there's a gag line in there, but
it
requires 15 minutes of setup. But but yeah, no, I mean, like, the notion of sex is just, like, the fact that he's... And he's technically a virgin. He's done a lot of stuff, you know, with previous girlfriends. But, in fact, I have a whole backstory I don't even talk about. Like, I think that his previous girlfriend was in New York, and he was becoming successful as an artist, was into, like, this tantric stuff where he never actually got off or something like that. But he did things. He just hadn't technically done the act.
Right.
And it was bugging him a little, And Meg, the woman that he's with in this story, just basically, like, everything was just like, from her point of view, it's just like, oh, okay, that explains it.
Right.
Because he's just, like, he's hung up in ways that she thinks are consistent.
And trapped in kind of his own head.
He's
trapped
in his head,
which is kind of the formalist dilemma, right? That is one of the dangers of
that is. Yeah, absolutely.
No.
But, yeah, no, there's definitely all kinds of linkages there to, like, themes that I've, you know, like, yeah, I only have so many themes. Come back to them.
That's right.
Oh, look,
right.
There's that one again. I guess Scott's like an 800-page author. He's like, he ran out at page 800, and now he's repeating.
That is not what I was trying to say. But I do think that the sculptor approaches it differently, because in Zot 35, I remember reading that issue and thinking, wow, it's really great that they're thinking seriously about this issue and taking it seriously and acknowledging their attraction for each other. But here, it's kind of like Meg just says, just do it, you know? Don't hesitate. Get out of your own head. And
well, he's like, when they're first doing it, he says something about, like, you know, I want to do it right. I want it to be good for you. And she kind of laughs and says, next time.
Right. Because she sets up the pretext of it being good enough for him, in the sense that she sets up the candles and the...
Oh, no, yeah. She does the whole thing, which I thought it was funny, because it's like, this is like shooting fish in a barrel. Because he's, like, at the end of the day, he's a very, very simple person, you know, when it comes to this. He just really... wants sex.
Right.
And so she, you know, she does the get up and the candles and everything. But, he's anxious because he wants it to be good for her. He wants to do, you know, do for her, like, what she's doing for him.
Right.
And she's just like, she laughs because it's like, we'll do that. That'll be our
we'll
second,
figure it out,
that'll be our second time. Just have fun.
Lower
right
the
now.
Bar a little bit.
Yeah.
I just wanted to mention, there's also a really large difference in age between Zot and Jenny and Meg. David.
Yeah, but Meg and David is in mid-20s,
It has a lot to do with why the younger ones are standing around talking or sitting around talking about
a lot longer. And that David is 26 and it's...
Yeah.
It's time.
It's time. But you know, the real key to that scene is that, you know, like, after things go a little, you know, a little slightly wrong, but whatever. You know, just when they're talking about various things, and you know, at one point Meg just casually says, you know, like, we're animals. Right. That's all the scene.
Yeah, they
is
look
about.
In the mirror and they say, we're animals.
Yeah, and that's and this whole thing is kind of an atheist manifesto anyway, despite the supernatural elements.
Now wait, you can't drop that and not explain it. Well, why an atheist manifesto? That's very interesting.
Well, I mean, like, this is a conversation with death. This is not, you know, this is not Faust, right? This is not.
Right.
I mean, it references it, and it has that basic structure of a deal with that supernatural entity,
right,
for powers, and then you have to give something. But he's not giving his soul. There is no soul. He's giving his days. He has 200 days to live.
Right.
And the whole thing is a conversation with death. You know, if you think this one that's supernatural it. Element that I have of death, everything comes from death. That's supernatural in the story. You know, if you he's the only thing we there's no.
There's a sort of contradiction there. I mean, in the sense sense that he gets supernatural agency, and yet in service of an atheist manifesto.
Yeah, I know. It's like Dave McKean is still pissed off at me for that, because he's like he's like in the Dawkins camp, not with the Dawkins of the last 2 days or whatever, but the atheist Dawkins.
Right.
I'm sorry, Dawkins.
There,
Dawkins is suddenly
band.
Very controversial this week.
Right.
But you know, like, and he really feels like you can't have any supernatural anything, and let's explain to children why there is no Santa Claus.
Wow.
You know, but I think that fiction, you know, fiction can be a lever from which to talk about the world that we live in. And the world that we live in is where you have a limited number of days before you die, and that's it. That's the premise of the story.
Absolutely.
Is like, you know, what do you do with the days? We all have a limited number of days. You know,
so we've all made
alert,
that deal with the
right. World. You're gonna die, and what are you gonna do? You just don't know the number.
Sure.
So like, I'm taking this supernatural story to talk about the world as it actually is.
Right. You know. That's interesting. Well, one of the things that we wanted to do for the panel is to actually talk about a sequence from the book.
Sure.
To move into talking about a sequence from the book, particularly from a formal perspective, and work with Scott in order to dissect it.
So talk to the formalists.
That's right.
Sure.
But
this
we're animals. We're animals, but we'll talk to this formalist animal over here about
this
section. But this is a scene from about 150 pages into the book.
Yeah, thereabouts, yeah.
Do you want to set it up for us, Scott?
Yeah, sure. Just quick backstory. I mean, this is a story about David is an artist named David Smith. He's a sculptor, which is a real burden because there's already a sculptor named David Smith, a very famous sculptor in the 20th century, long dead.
Did you get his permission?
No, I did not.
No, long dead. supernatural agency itself.
Who didn't copyright the name. So he has the burden of always being the other David Smith, and he makes this deal with death that where he has these sculpting superpowers. There are superpowers, I have to admit it. And in exchange, he only has 200 days to live. But things have gone horribly wrong, as this big showing that he worked so hard at was a complete failure. And now he's facing this idea that he traded away his days for nothing.
Right.
And he's very depressed. He winds up homeless for various reasons that are uninteresting. And here he is in the New York Public Library, and he's looking up. He's trying to find this person who might be able to help him. But he has to hold things throughout the whole story. He's always holding stuff.
It's really hand intensive.
Yeah, he's very that's another motif, lots of hands.
Right.
But he has to hold things, so he actually convinces them to go into storage and find him an old printed phone book.
Yes.
So, you know, here he is in the library.
Well, I keep wanting to do spoilers about hands and stuff. I won't do any spoilers.
Okay, good. All right, good. Here we go. Sorry. Do a thing. There we go. So here he is, you know, at the library, and like laced throughout this is this memory of a conversation with his parents where they're telling him he can be anything, but his dad says this thing about how you have to make a name for yourself, and that leads.
Right.
That leads into where he just on a whim decides to look up his own name.
And all those multiples.
And that's what he sees is all these David Smiths. So he's not even the only ordinary David Smith.
Right.
This idea of losing identity is a really big deal in the story.
Right. And in the face of death, in the face of, as you say, sort of an atheistic oblivion, what else is going to survive beyond you?
Exactly. And ultimately, this is a story about not so much about trying to be remembered as this is a story about a terror of being forgotten.
Right.
That's what this is all about. It's like this is somebody who's afraid of being forgotten, who's afraid in many ways has already been forgotten.
But whose fear of being forgotten means that he doesn't connect with the people around him, which
right.
is one
exactly.
problem.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, and he feels that separation, hence right. the like the crowd ring stuff.
Right, right. He's put so much pressure on himself to be remembered that he's forgotten even by some of the people in his life.
Yeah,
he
right.
neglects them.
He allows himself to drift from life.
Right.
His connection to the people around him is right. like this big gap in his life. Right. So like from a formal standpoint, I'm like, you'll notice something that I have, it's a two color book, and I'm always doing this thing with using colors for, this is a tiny panel, right? Mm-hmm. You know, this panel on the left,
right.
the New York Public Library. But when I'm able to use black and then that second color, mm-hmm. I'll use the second color to pull things back.
Right.
See, there he is in the reading room on
to
the left.
To kind of establish
there.
A kind of ambiance in the background?
Or just a sense of depth. It's just
sure.
pure depth. That and that sense of like greater depth, or gray or more cavernous depth.
Right.
So here, sorry. Here's something like, look, see those two panels of him walking mm-hmm. and then
yep.
that?
Yep.
This is something I talk about in Understanding Comics. This is a 1+1=3 effect, or right. like what the Gestalts would say, like that the whole is other than the sum
or
of its parts.
Or Eisenstein montage.
Or Eisenstein's montage,
third,
right. Yeah, exactly. So like, I'm not showing you rain in that panel, right? Can you see the arrow, the cursor? Yeah. You see, I'm not showing you rain there. I'm just showing it here, and
right.
so we transplant the fact that, yeah, it's not only a soggy day, but a few drops are
right.
coming down.
Well, and it also isn't, it's the center panel is open, which means that it's kind of like really raining. It's like
right.
the rain literally bleeds off the page.
Well,
like
that's it.
Talk about with bleeds.
Yeah, bleeds are literal. Yeah, literal bleeds. Right, things that go off the page are
right.
also like if you think of the panel as a container for time, then one of the things that happens when you break the container, this is it's
that it elongates
quite,
the moment.
Well,
yes.
yeah, it's mm-hmm. quite nearly literal, right? You're breaking the container of the panel that said yes, this is I am containing a moment. Okay, now because of the bleed, or
right.
and this is that. Also the case of like vignettes like that one,
mm-hmm.
Then that means that you're breaking open the idea of a finite chunk of time.
Right.
And instead it bleeds. Think of it as like time is a liquid. It bleeds
yes.
into the rest of
yes.
the. That's why they're so good for establishing shots.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because that means that when you're looking at the panels after
right.
the establishing shot, it's the idea of the establishing shot is
right.
still permeating what happens.
In some ways,
it.
Then the establishing shot that has a bleed in it kind of functions almost like an aspect-to-aspect panel. Where
well, it
it's
is,
like,
yeah.
it's a descriptive moment, and then you begin
absolutely.
Or resume the narrative.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
And so it influences everything that comes after it. So anyway, so you have those two. And then the situation is basically, he's homeless, he's wandering, it's getting soggy out, he hasn't eaten in 4 days, which means he's borderline delirious.
Right,
right.
right?
And also,
and
he's
hearing voices
and
in his head.
And he's hideously lonely, right? And this the object of his affection is this woman who was just like this momentary
right. this
person who flew down, told him everything would be all right, and then disappeared.
Right.
Right. And that was part of that street stunt. So he's still thinking about her on some level. And we have this voice, want to grab a bite? And he says, can't. Made promises, no charity, no stealing. He has all these
right.
promises
inflexible
to himself.
Rules
yeah,
to live
Yeah, very inflexible rules. And then we see her. That's her, the woman from that street theater stunt. And she says, got to eat something. And he just takes it for granted that he's talking to her
so
now.
So why the bleed in the second panel there?
Because it looked better. There isn't always a good reason. Doesn't matter anymore, he says, just let me go, I'm not worth it. Remember, he failed, his showing failed.
Right.
And then she says, when's the test? And he says, it's called a showing and it's already over. I bet my life on my so-called talent, I lost. So go ahead, tell me everything will be all right, even though it won't, even though it's all bullshit, go ahead. Right. Remember, this is what her angel
right.
character told him when she flew down, is everything will be all right.
Right.
And then, suddenly, it's like there's that moment of disorientation where this imaginary voice in his head is still going.
Right.
And we don't know where it's coming from, but suddenly you hear, oh, that's plenty of time. Come on, we can even go to that shitty hot dog place you like. And now we have these three word balloons here in the third panel,
right.
one of which continues, my treat, but now we're hearing other voices.
All this sort of cacophony around.
Yeah, exactly.
Or at least the cacophony in his head.
And now, and what I'm hoping for is that you will remember what this
right,
feels
right,
like.
Right.
This is so important in comics. You only have one sense. You have sight.
Right.
And you have to somehow convey all five senses and all the other experiences that we have in our heads.
Right.
Okay, do you remember how different it is when you have a hood on and it's raining out, and the difference when you take off the hood,
right,
and now you can locate sound.
And in this sequence, that's the first sort of full-on close-up shot that we have of David, too.
Right, yeah, and I'm trying to save up my
And he looks haunted. I mean, you sort of save that as sort of a mini sort of climax in that panel where he takes it off, and the emaciation and the lack of eating for like 4 days.
You can hopefully you see the tension is all written in his face.
Right.
But you're also remembering. You're remembering what it's like. You take off the hood. Now you can turn your head and you can begin to locate where sound is. But now the voices are everywhere.
Right.
Because he's in Times Square. I never show Times Square. Right? That is, I don't have that big establishing shot because he was looking at the ground. He was in his own head. So there is no establishing shot for us because this is all POV.
Is that deliberate to make it more disorienting?
Yeah, more in his head and it's more disorienting. But now this is my portrait of Times Square entirely in voices, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some of them from abroad, some of them not even in English. You know, all these people talking about things that we recognize as Times Square.
Right.
But he's looking only for one voice. He's trying to hear one
to hear his angel,
voice,
to hear,
to hear this woman that suddenly he realizes is the woman and is actually there.
Right.
She's somewhere in the crowd.
Do you think this is another example of his pathology, too? Because a lot of what the word balloons say are these things like, oh, you know, the umbrella, or oh, the donut, or whatever.
Those are actual phrases.
Well, certainly, but... You know, for someone who's sitting there going, dealing with these sort of mega issues of art, life, and death, mm-hmm. to hear this would be a sort of undue and unwelcome distraction from those.
Well, actually, it's not so much an unwelcome distraction, it's just figure and ground, right? It's just like, and this is how we perceive the world, is we have this shifting relationship of figure and ground at all times. If you think about it, what you hear when you walk into any scene like this one or any other, go out and walk through Bethesda, is you see 10 million different things.
10 million different stories.
You know, you have 10 million sights greeting your eye, you have 10 million sounds, you have all these smells, and you have to somehow isolate the two or three things that are useful for you. And again, going back to Gestalt theory, that's the same idea. It's like the ways in which we simplify the world. Think of the world as an army of archers that's sending a million arrows towards you every second of the day, and it's your job to reach up and go and grab the one that's heading right for you.
Okay.
And somehow discard the rest. You're always doing that sort. This is a way of my visually showing you that sorting process, where,
especially in that panel there, where you use the two-tone in order to zero in on a figure that
and that's, and this is something that happened earlier as well when he was following her at a party, trying to find out who she was, And then again, you know, here you have these three panels where that middle panel is influencing our perception of the other two panels, and we know that the rain is starting to get worse. And then, boom, it comes tumbling.
Right. That's almost like a shot from Hitchcock's Foreign Correspondent, where the army of umbrellas hides her from his view.
It is. It's very Hitchcock. You know, like I like from Strangers on a Train, there's an amazing thing where there's a murderer who is stalking a tennis champion.
Yes.
And there's an amazing shot of like the entire crowd as the tennis match is going and the ball is going back and forth and back and forth. You see, as you actually see in a tennis match, you see the crowd and everybody's
looking
heads are going
left,
to the left,
to the right,
to the right, to the left, to the right. And there's this one guy who's only looking one way.
Directly at somebody.
And that's the same kind of like sorting thing where you're taking this very complex array of information and saying there is despite the complexity, there's only one meaningful data point here to this
arrow you're trying to capture.
That's the one arrow that you're reaching up and capturing. So, you know, here's this thing, you know, like where he's just, remember the everything will be all right thing, and he said it was bullshit, but now he's saying, come back, please, I'm sorry, you can say it if you want. And, you know, he's back, he's alone again, he can't find her in the rain. So he goes in, and there's an actual, like, okay, Metro cards in New York? Does anyone live in New York? Okay, do you remember the optimism cards? There was like, for a while, they had the little Metro card said optimism on the back. And
it's almost too good a symbol. You can't use it, right?
I know. But I had to do that. I thought that was so funny. And then so it goes in. And like, you know, sometimes you just want a silent panel so you can just like have a sense of a place going in here.
And if not now, when, with a woman?
the woman, I've got to cop. I'm not a great figure drawer. So I copped that from Women Laughing Alone with Salad. Do you remember? That's like, I found a pose.
You and your
it.
Internet memes.
Yeah, well, I played with it. That one's just so beautiful. And then, you know, like, again, what happens between the panels? You know, he sits down, there's this guy here, sort of notices him, and then he says, yeah, I know, you and me. And then in the next panel, the guy's just gone. We know as human beings that as soon as somebody sits down near you on a subway station and starts talking to no one in particular, it's time to get up
here.
And move. Yeah. And then David says this thing, remember 10th grade, how Haley Robbins wanted a portrait of Chad from Nickelback? God, we hated those guys. I didn't know that, when I wrote that, I didn't know that hating Nickelback was a thing. I'm sorry. I just thought.
Just surfing on that cultural zeitgeist there.
Yeah, he just seemed like the kind of guy who would hate Nickelback. Many, many do. And then he says, but you drew it, you took one for the team, and I got kissed under the stairs while you slipped inside that sweater, but we grew older, and you, and then we'd see, he's talking to his hands. And like, there are a couple of things going on here, like, again, remember I mentioned the thing about the depth, right? Okay, so I'm using black to knock things forward, I'm using the color to knock things back, but if you notice the lines on the ground, the tiles on the ground, first of all, it's a little bit tilted, so it's a little disoriented, but also it's almost flaring up at the top, which says that you're almost like pitching forward, so there's that sense that you are looking at the hands, but you're also not in a really stable place.
Right.
You're about to pitch forward, and he stands up, and you'll notice this time, same shot, but now it's tilted a little bit. That disorientation.
That canting.
Yeah, that Batman villain cave tilt.
Third man.
Yeah, and he's basically screaming at his hands and screaming at his hands, and now we have this simultaneity where we have like the sound effects are imposed between the panels. Mm-hmm. Again, that sense of bleeding, right? So that they're permeating over the whole scene. He's yelling at his hands. The figure drawing gets a little shittier. He gets more and more angry.
Shittier.
No, not really deliberate. I never quite like these figures. And he's screaming and screaming at his hands, and then you get this. And that for me was like that really summed up that moment,
right.
And because that simultaneity that you get that disorientation if there's almost too much coming to your senses, you have that sense of that enormously loud sound that's taking up more and more of the panel. You have the sense of the furious motion of a subway train,
and the way the letters on the rumble are a little blurred, as if they're just sort of everywhere and just kind of disseminating into the entire.
Yeah, and they have that set. They don't have any limit to them. They're bleeding out into everything, and then they get bigger and bigger and bigger as he reaches. And then like I have this interior shot. You can see inside the subway car, and you know that like the sound is there, but it's also like this for them. It's just like crazy guy on window just for a moment, and then he blacks out basically, and somebody catches
and him. We find out, of course,
and we find out.
We have probably just about 10 minutes left in the panel, and one of the things that you wanted to do also is take questions about the sculptor or anything else. So there's a mic right there in the aisle, so if anybody would like to go up there and ask a question, please do.
That was a little crazy. Did that have a crazy feel? Was that a little bit? Was I a little frantic?
Yeah, I mean, a little frantic. The guy's having a mental breakdown. I think it's more than a little frantic.
Was the speaker having a mental breakdown is what I want to know.
Can you talk a bit about your process for the sculptor and also how your process has changed with using a computer and that sort of thing?
Well, I'll have to do this super quick because this is like a whole thing in itself. Whoops. Sorry, but I will show you that. Here, wait. No, ignore that. Ignore that.
Looks like a lot of work.
Yeah, go down. Yeah. Okay, here's the... I drew it 40 pages at a time in Photoshop. You can find YouTubes of me talking about this online, so I don't want to dwell on it too much. But basically, I... 40 pages at a time, the idea being that I didn't want to really get too hung up on individual pages.
Right.
And so I did these roughs that aren't all that rough. You can see they're kind of anal retentive.
Much more precise than most thumbnails.
But the idea is I wanted to have these clear like slots on top where I could take panels if I wanted to take a panel out. It's a little like word processing. Take a panel out and like put it on that sort of that top row. And store it and store other panels up there. And then I could kind of reintroduce the panel when I needed to reintroduce.
And this was the hardest process for you, right?
This is the
most time intensive.
This is the most time intensive, and I did a lot of different drafts. But I like the idea of things reflowing, and I like the idea of not getting too hung up on the composition on the individual page. It's just more of a forward flow. It's just a lot like word processing. I wanted people to feel like they were always being pushed into the next panel, regardless of whether it was the end of a page or the middle of the page.
It's your secret animist kind of.
Yeah, that's the secret. Yeah, like I just wanted it to be about the reading, and then, you know, like I did the lettering and created these. The lettering was an illustrator, and then I created these windows where I was drawing behind the window, and I don't want, you know, that's a whole other lecture right there. All of it's digital, everything, including the layouts.
Yeah. I may be misremembering this, but I seem to recall a story about Will Eisner talking to Rube Goldberg, and Rube Goldberg berated Will Eisner, saying, you know, we're just cartoonists, it's not
that's
art.
Yeah, that's reinventing comics, right?
Yeah, Will felt that comics could be a legitimate literary and artistic form, the fool, and actually told a reporter that back in the 40s, I think it was. And he was at a party with Rube Goldberg, and I love that Will Eisner could drop names like Rube Goldberg. And Rube Goldberg was like, "That's bullshit, kid. We're just vaudevillians.
That's right. And entertaining in the newspaper.
Yeah, we're just entertaining them in the newspapers."
Well, I wonder if you maybe feel a certain sense of guilt for lending a legitimacy to comics. So now there's a sort of expectation of quality. Where it used to be just like,
how dare you raise the bar, Scott?
You see, we are so back here, right? we're back in the four tribes, the campfires, right? That's one of the things, is that like the lower right here really is distrustful of the idea of comics finally gaining recognition as a literary and artistic form, because that means all those rich fuckers in their museums and hallowed institutions are going to kill all the vitality.
Right.
And that's always been a genuine concern on the part of many on that sort of the bottom half of the chart. They don't care on the top. That's fine.
Yeah, Kane.
Hey, Kane.
Hey. I thought it was interesting that you said that iconoclasts are humble, because they certainly can be, but it made me think about when Dan Nadel was bagging on you on the Comics Journal before the book even came out, and I feel like there's...
Doesn't mean he's not humble.
Maybe he's personally humble, but I feel like there was an implication, like, it wasn't like a criticism of the actual book that existed, which is potentially valid, but just the idea that you're doing, like, an epic, sincere, narrative, 800-page, messy thing is, like, intrinsically, like, middle brow and distasteful, you know?
Yeah,
but, like,
no, I mean, I think it's... You know, I think it sticks because it is a very sentimental book. It's a very, you know, puffy, big, you know, sort of pretentious-y thing.
It's like a
rock opera or something, which is like a prog rock opera. It's about as uncool as it could possibly be. I have never been less cool than I am in 2005. So 2015. You see? That's proof.
Scott McCloud, uncool for a decade.
Actually, all my whole life. But yeah, no, but I think basically that, you know, like the natural like constitution of the thing kind of doomed it to that slot.
Right.
But the thing is, of course, what am I about? Like, my whole career is that comics can do anything. I'd never seen anyone do anything quite like this. And I wanted to say comics can do this too. And now the question is, but Scott, should comics do this?
Well,
and I still think yes, but I understand the criticism.
Implicit in Kane's question, of course, is we can categorize artists in those camps. Do you think the critics follow along? That is, do you think there are critics you can lump into particular camps?
Well, you see, there's the problem.
Yeah, well, I don't want to drop names.
The word lump. See? That's where it gets toxic. Yeah, I haven't even named names. Oh, I had names. Look, I had notes. There were some cool names there. Yeah, no, I think basically if you're drawn to be a critic, if you have a passion for being a critic, then you're probably either going to have a passion for people who fail to innovate and do something genuinely new, which is more of a formalist thing, or you're going to have a passion for unmasking people who are insincere or whose work is false and you know, perpetuating either societal
not
norms
the
or cliches or tropes or whatever. And so, you know, like I said, remember that it's all about, like, the bottom is all about revolution. And I think that's sort of where that impulse lives. But of course, you know, you'll find, I suppose, like anyone, you'll find critics on all four corners. But right. the interesting ones live,
the
live in the bottom.
In the bottom.
Yeah,
right.
yeah. And they've got to pull out the long knives, even if they have to skewer people like me in the process. I think it's part of the ecosystem of ideas that comics is built on. Yeah.
All right. Another question?
So in reading the sculpture, I mean, whether, you know, saying whether it really was death or not, but it seems that David's on a self-fulfilling prophecy path there, yeah. that he believes that, you know, it's going to happen, and everything he does just leads to the point at the end of the book.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I know what you're saying. Weirdly enough, I never thought of it, is that, like, he's told he has 200 days to live, but without getting all spoilery,
yeah.
I suppose we don't exactly have a demonstration that was true. but yeah, yeah. I wish we could get into specifics, but that would
yeah,
be dangerous.
Yeah, we're trying to
yeah.
dodge the last
yeah,
200 pages
yeah.
in particular.
Yeah, but that's fascinating, and it's really cool that after all this time, that's the first time I even thought of it in that way.
Yes, another question?
So I was waiting for your next book for a long time. I love the sculpture. It's very emotional. And I was, not what I was expecting, is that there was a story seed in making comics mm-hmm. with like a witch girl. I mean, like, are you going to go back and do something frivolous and light again?
What's
or
the next,
are you now,
what's the next project?
Now you are you committed to... breaking our hearts.
Well, anytime anything works, my first impulse is like, can't do that again.
you know, I was like, piss off enough critics.
Yeah, no, that's not why. No, when I was a kid, I liked the Beatles because every single time they had like, you know, a hit record, which was every single time, they were like, okay, did that. And now, like, everybody wants another one just like that. Let's you know, piss them off and do something completely different. And
let's give them I Am the Walrus instead.
Yeah, and I thought that's how you stay vital. And, you know, like, the idea was, like, wow, by the time I'm 55, maybe I'll still be, you know, have a panel at SPX or whatever. and I think that is kind of the key. And I had Will Eisner as a, you know, who had several different acts, who reinvented his career several times. As kind of a model. I mean, he was 59. He was 4 years older than me when he did his first graphic novel. And he went on to do 27 more before he croaked. So, you know, you really think
humbling.
About that. Yeah.
Humbling.
It's like, how do you be vital? It's like, yeah. and part of it for me is just like, I try to listen to everyone and, you know, and follow no one and watch for patterns, that sort of thing. Right. Just try to keep an open mind, basically.
How about one more question?
Sure. Hi, Scott. My name is Ramon Gill. And
hi,
I've been reading you since Zot, and ever since understanding comics, you have been pushing for innovation in the industry and in the genre, and also for us to you actually mentioned in the book that we've only just barely scratched the surface, and there's so much more potential for the genre or for the medium.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering now, I mean, it's been, 20 years, something like that, since 25 years, since understanding comics, how far along do you feel we've come in mining or getting into that potential? And you were here 10 years ago doing, you know, talking about other things. Where do you see us 10 years from now?
Well, I think 10 years from, well, to answer the first question first, in the follow-up to Understanding Comics, Reinventing Comics, which came out in 2000, I actually sort of gave
right.
a series of metrics to measure that progress.
Right. Diversity.
Yeah, there
like
were
that.
There were a lot. There
right,
were
yeah.
so three of them had to do with you know the advent of digital technology.
Right.
There were things like, you know, our standing as literature, as art, the various metrics of diversity, and we're doing pretty good. I mean, like we're doing really really well in a lot of those. I felt like probably the one that was lagging the most was racial diversity, and that's, you know, something. If anyone saw the Black Art Matters,
yes,
was it Black Art or Black Artists?
Black
Art Matters. That's starting to, you know, like we feel like, okay, come on, let's work on that. Still very lot of pale faces at you know art comic shows. But the rest of them are doing really well, and you know, I still have hopes for experimentation on the web. I think we've become a little conservative in terms of that stuff, but I had to take time off to do my big fat printed book, you know, and that took a while, so I've kind of been on the sidelines.
And that's your next project, right? To sort of get back into webcomics?
Sort of. The next project is actually a nonfiction book about visual communication. I want to see if I can figure out the common denominators of it's a huge thing. Anyway, but that's that, and then I'll probably get back to experimental webcomics. But we're doing good. We're doing really, really good in a lot of ways. We have much more diversity. We're rebuilding the sort of the foundation of our readership, which is just pure storytelling for kids, which helps to feed into, you know, the stuff as they grow older, that they become more adventurous readers. Obviously the web is an integral part of what we're doing. The graphic novels movement has never been stronger. Art comics still burns as bright as it has, you know, for the last 20 years. Yeah. And we're in really, really good shape. And I think in 10 years, the real thing to watch is what happens to Rain as kids. and I do have that old prediction from 2004 that I've been like watching the clock, where I'd said that I thought by 2024 that we would have a majority female industry and art form. And I think that we may be ahead of schedule.
Close.
Yeah, we're ahead of schedule.
On those inspirational words, we have to finish it off. But thank you all for being here. And let's say thanks to Scott.
Thank you.